When he was 23 years old, Norman Granz went to see the Ink Spots and Ella Fitzgerald, who were on the same bill. Apparently he wasn't terribly impressed with Ella, which is ironic, considering that it was in 1956 that Norman founded the Verve labels specifically for Ella Fitzgerald to record on. A few years after seeing Ella in Los Angeles, Norman Granz started to organise concerts, which culminated in the very first Jazz at the Philharmonic. And what was so interesting in what Granz was doing was he was taking jazz out of the clubs and putting it on stage in a setting that he thought was right and proper for artists of the caliber who he loved, the Lester Youngs, the Nat King Coles, to work with. These concerts became a regular feature. Very quickly, he started to organise what became this template for touring jazz, and indeed has become the template for modern rock tours. But what was particularly interesting in what Granz did was he insisted that there would be no segregation at any of his concerts. And in America at this point, there was still, particularly in the southern states, segregation. Granz took a step which to us seems obvious, but at the time was a very creative concept. He decided he'd record his concerts, and having recorded them, the obvious thing was to release them as records. Initially there were 78 RPM records, and they were collected together in what were called albums, and these became the Jazz at the Philharmonic series, which were hugely successful. And in recording them, he also set up his own record label, Clef Records. This was in 1947, so over the next few years, he not only recorded Jazz at the Philharmonic, the artists who played on the Jazz at the Philharmonic, he recorded in the studios. And gradually he increased the number of recordings that Clef owned, became so successful that he then started Norgran Records. In 1955, he finally managed to wrestle Ella Fitzgerald's contract away from Decca Records. Ella had been appearing at the Jazz at the Philharmonic. Norman had become her manager. He was not convinced that Decca knew how to record Ella. He had ideas of his own, and so he started Verve Records. This was at the beginning of 1956. And within a matter of a month, he put Ella into the studio in Los Angeles with Buddy Bregman, who was his arranger and conductor, and they started work on the Cole Porter songbook. Ella Fitzgerald sings the Cole Porter songbook. This was the cornerstone, if you like, of what Granz felt was the way to present Ella, and it is an amazing album. It's an album that no self-respecting music fan should be without. Within months of starting Verve Records and working on the Ella Fitzgerald songbook and recording some other artists, Granz decided he would amalgamate all of his record companies into Verve. So Clef and Norgran became part of Verve. That immediately gave him a huge roster of recordings. He's got all the Charlie Parker records that he recorded in the late 40s and early 50s, possibly the most famous of which is Charlie Parker with Strings. He had Dizzy Gillespie, he had Count Basie, he had Lester Young, and he had Oscar Peterson. And Oscar Peterson, along with Ella, became a key artist for Verve. In fact, was the most recorded artist on the Verve label. And indeed, Louis Armstrong, who was hugely successful. The Louis Armstrong All-Stars were which one of the most popular bands in America, and Louis himself was amazingly popular. And Granz took the possibly unusual step in many people's eyes of putting Louis and Ella in the studio together. And they recorded three albums together, Ella and Louis again, and The Amazing Porgy and Bess. It is the definitive recording of the Gershwin's opera. Louis, while he sang, was a completely different singer to Ella. But what made it such a unique, those three albums so unique and interesting, was the combination of the purity of Ella's voice and the gruffness of Louis, along with Louis's trumpet playing. But that was Granz genius. He could take artists and put them together. And it stemmed from the days of the early JATP and the jam sessions. He would put artists together and they created magic. Well, of course, it's all about the music. Jazz has always had a very close affinity with art, graphic art. Norman Granz was astute enough to spot the talent of David Stone Martin. He designed what became the JATP logo, the trumpet player. And then from there, whenever Norman Granz released a record, it was invariably a David Stone Martin design cover. And his art is very interesting. It's line art, but it's got a fantastic use of cover. He just had a way of putting cover art that somehow reflected the music, but definitely operated in its own space. And what was particularly interesting about Stone Martin is that he was able to not get too stuck in one look. It's a very important part of Verve Records is the look of the albums. The 1960s was this incredibly fertile period for Verve Records. In 1960, Norman Granz, after flirting with the idea of selling Verve to Frank Sinatra's fledgling record label Reprise, he decided to sell to MGM Records. How do you replace somebody who's such a strong character as Norman Granz? Very, very difficult. Enter Creed Taylor. Creed Taylor had started Impulse Records. He was another man with a clear vision of what he wanted to do, and it didn't change the ethos of the company. It was still very strongly aligned with good-looking records, well-made records, and there was a new period for Verve, coinciding with an upsurge in interest in bossa nova and Latin American music. Charlie Bird had gone to South America and was enamored with the bossa nova rhythms and the music of Antonio Carlos Jobim. He came back, met Stan Getz, and the two of them worked together and created one of the definitive and defining albums of the bossa nova period. This was followed after about a year and a half later with Getz working with Joao Gilberto and his wife, Astrid. And they, of course, recorded The Girl from Ipanema. And then as the 60s went on, artists like Willy Bobo, who recorded the original version of Evil Ways, which became an anthem for Santana. There was Cal Chader, was another one of the artists that came through the Latin groove. But what makes bossa nova so interesting and what was so important for Verve and just the development of jazz in general is it's how many people actually got into listening to jazz. They didn't start with the more challenging music perhaps of Charlie Parker or Dizzy Gillespie or Leo Konitz. They started by listening to bossa nova, and having explored bossa nova, they went out from there. Jazz was on the charts for the one and only time, really, in its life. But what's interesting and should be remembered is that Verve isn't just about history. It's not just about an old label and not just about an archive. Verve Records is still very much alive and well. It's now run by David Foster, the multi-Grammy award-winning producer, arranger, songwriter. David Foster is taking Verve into a new era, and it's something that Norman Granz would have approved of. It's all about having hit records.